Right, we gotta get out of here. Give me 5 rounds rapid, cover me, I'm going for that ditch over there. I can give you 10. No, just 5 rounds. It's only over there. Don't worry, just fine.
Why not?
Don't you remember my score at Depo? Not practice. Practice 7, I think it was. It was 10 rounds rapid, that was. I can give it to you. I don't care about Depo. I don't care about your score. Just fire 5 rounds fast now. Yeah, but 10's, don't you think 10's better? No? I mean, I was really good at it. I don't care. Just shoot 5 rounds rapid. I really think 10 would be better. Oh my God, we're gonna die. Fine, shoot 10 rounds.
Good then. 10 it is.
By the midpoint in the war, the annual rifle course had been condensed considerably. Any vestige of the complex and comprehensive rifle course, as was practiced in 1939, had ceased to exist. This, of course, being due to wartime economies in time, material, and facilities. In this video, we'll examine the rifle course as practiced from 1942 to the end of the war. Details of this practice are found in the document entitled Range Courses War of that same year. Now, despite the fact that the rifle course from 1942 was indeed condensed over that practiced before the war, it's nevertheless important to realize that the rifle course was part of a greater musketry program. The overall training for the infantryman was indeed comprehensive by this point. So, tin hats on. Welcome back to Stone Forest Ranges. Let's do some shooting. The outbreak of war had led to a degree of simplification and economy to musketry training and range work in particular. The initial abridged wartime rifle course of late 1939 had served the expanding army as a reasonable, though not necessarily comprehensive, standard. This was modified slightly in 1942, when the Small Arms Training Series of manuals was rewritten. In this later version, zeroing was to be a separate activity, whereas it was included as a practice in the 1939 version. In addition, the 42 version saw a reintroduction of shooting at a distance greater than 300 yards, with a single 5-round application added as the final practice. Despite its rather short length, it did, however, cover most of the basic shooting techniques. Application, snap, and rapid practices were contained therein, along with shooting from a trench, as well as shooting while wearing a respirator. In this video, I've chosen to demonstrate the firing of this course using the number 4. Entering service on a large scale from 1943, it would have been this course that the men training for the invasion of Normandy, or those waiting as replacements for Italy, and other campaigns would have undertaken. As mentioned in the introduction, the reference for this shoot is the 1942 Range Courses War. This can be found at the excellent Vickers Machine Gun website. The link is in the description below. It's an excellent website and contains many period manuals and texts. You might consider making a donation. Now, this manual also details range work for the remainder of the suite of weapons used by the infantry, as seen here. But it's the rifle that we'll most necessarily be interested in here. The ammunition used for this shoot was a bit of a special case, pardon the pun. James, a friend of the channel, kindly donated a small cache of 1943 dated Mark 7 ammunition, along with a small smattering of Mark 7Z. This numbered in the neighborhood of 100 rounds and is still outwardly in excellent condition. The use of them was an excellent way to put my new number 4, which at the time of this video had only recently come into my possession, through its paces. Thank you, James. The distinct smell of cordite was a welcome distraction. The targets for this course were of conventional size and shape, although they differed in detail from those which had been used during the first half of the war. The 1942 manual stipulated a return to the use of proper figure targets for aiming marks and bullseyes, replacing the semicircular tin hat style that had been used since the 1920s. these new mid-war versions were very similar to those used during the Great War. The small, or 4-foot classification target was gray, with a figure 5 in the center. There were scoring rings at 24, 36, and 48 inches. For grouping practices, this was fitted with a white aiming mark, 3 inches by 4 inches, pasted on the upper half of the figure 5. The large or 6-foot classification target was of similar color, with a figure 3 at its center. Scoring rings of 36, 48, and 72 inches were included. This target was used alone at 500 yards. In use from the 1930s, the figure 4A, itself a modification of the number 4 figure dating from the time of the Great War, it was of similar size. This updated version used multiple colors to represent a more contemporary enemy, lying prone and wearing a helmet. This target was used for snap shooting. The classification targets were mounted in conventional hithe pattern target frames that would raise and lower. For snap shooting, the figure 4A was mounted on a handheld stick for presentation above the berm and the butts. Scoring for the 1942 rifle course was thus, and those familiar with the musketry of 1914 series will see some common principles here. For grouping practices, the figure and scoring rings were immaterial, aside from providing an aiming mark. A set of wire rings was used with a 4, 8, and 12-inch variation. A grouping of less than 4 inches scored 25 points. That less than 8, 20. That less than 12 inches, 15 points. And 10 points was reserved for a 12-inch grouping with one flyer outside. For application practices, the figure was worth 4 points. The inner 3, the magpie 2, and the outer 1. The remainder of the target was worth 0. The use of the large or 6-foot target followed the same principles. For rapid practices, the figure and inner were in effect combined, yielding 3 points for hits in either. 2 for the magpie, and 1 for the outer, with the customary 0 for the remainder of the target. For snap practices using the number 4A, any hit thereon scored 3 points. I must make mention of some continuity discrepancies that may be noticed during this video. It has, in fact, taken many trips to complete filming of the project, and visits to different locations in order to shoot at the prescribed ranges. Time of day, location, and in particular weather may be different in the various practices as filmed. This is simply the reality of how I must structure such endeavors. I must also make note of the way the targets are presented during some of the practices. Without the facilities of a full range, I'm forced to make certain adjustments. Firstly, my targets certainly aren't manned, and therefore to create the different timed exposures, I'm forced to shoot to the time of a stopwatch. For demonstrative purposes, I've created digital models of targets appearing and disappearing. This to better illustrate the way the targets would appear and disappear. There were 8 practices in the 1942 rifle course. There was a grouping and application practices, snap shooting, rapid, and what was termed a timed practice, which although was not necessarily rapid in nature, it was, however, to be shot under the constraints of 1 minute. The ranges used were from 100 to 500 yards. Before we begin the practices of the 1942 rifle course, mention should be made of a specific requirement. The text stipulates that nearly all the practices were to be shot with the bayonet fixed. Now, no specific mention of the number 4 is made in this regard, and therefore the requirement to zero the number 4, equipped with a Mark II backsight with a fixed bayonet, must be taken independently of this range work, as the mention of fixed bayonets would also apply equally to the number 1. Therefore, I've shot the practices with the bayonet on, even though I was using a Mark I backsight on my number 4. Practice number 1 was a 5-round grouping from 100 yards in a lying supported position at a small, or 4-foot, classification target fitted with a white aiming mark. For this, a sandbag would have almost certainly been used. Here, I've used my own rest, one that viewers of the channel will be most familiar with.
With 5 rounds low. 100. Five rounds grouping. Fire.
Interestingly, the use of Mark 7 surface ammunition was accompanied by a surprisingly mild recoil. Of course, this was more than my own cast loads that I've become accustomed to shooting, but also was not anything like the recoil felt when using modern factory ammunition. Now, as prescribed in the manual, zeroing was to be done as a separate evolution before coming onto the range to shoot the course. This I had done, but as we shall see, some fine tuning was still required.
Not too bad. So that was a five-round grouping for 100. Practice number one. Got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 right in there. And the spread is just a shade under 3.5 inches. So that's well within the 4-inch minimum requirement for the best score of 25 points. Now, as you can see here, the zero isn't quite what it should be. I'm shooting a little bit to the right. That said, this is a grouping practice, not an application practice. So it's the size of the group that matters here, not its placement on the target.
So, with a group of 3.5 inches, I was able to enter a decent score for this practice. Practice number two was a 5-round application from 200 yards standing in a trench at a 4-foot classification target. For this practice, to be honest, I didn't feel like spending many hours digging and revetting a trench. So I called into service the shooting bench that I had built and used for a similar representation for the Mad Minute videos of the Musketry of 1914 series. It can be seen in use in part 4B of that series. This contraption afforded all the characteristics of a properly constructed period fire trench, what without the digging. Shooting this way is extremely stable and comfortable, perhaps more so than the prone or lying position. The parapet of the trench provides for the resting of the elbows and the left hand atop a sandbag gripping the forestock. It also affords a certain positive tension of the body as it's pushed by the feet into the front face of the trench. Very stable indeed. Here we see a couple of rounds that had a very slight hang fire. Par for the course, really, for almost 80-year-old ammunition. A good test of the observance of proper marksmanship principles, if there ever was one.
So, practice number two, 5-round application from the 200, standing in a trench. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I got 3 decent hits. I just cut the black here, and I missed one there on the right. So that gives a total score of 19.
It was close to perfect, but not quite still. Marching steadily towards that first class goal with a total of 44. Practice number 3 was a 5-round snap of 5 5-second exposures from 200 yards standing in a trench at a figure 4A. In earlier versions of this course, and indeed dating all the way back to before the Great War, snap shooting was done from what had by 1939 become known as the position of readiness. Here, the firer had to hide behind cover, concealing both himself and his weapon, only raising himself and aiming when the target appeared. In the 1942 version, this changed, and the man was permitted to engage the target from the aiming position. Despite the luxury of being allowed to engage from the aim, I did here revert to more of an alert position, with both eyes open observing the target area, then aiming proper once the exposure began.
So, that was the 200-yard snap. 5 rounds, 5-second exposures, 1 round per exposure, from the standing in a trench position. 1, 2, 3, 4. And I shanked one here, low. Which is unfortunate. Being 3 points per hit, that leaves me with a score of 12.
One more click up on the backside would have seen a perfect score here. Despite this, building the total to 56 was a step in the right direction. Practice 4 was a 5-round timed application of 1 60-second exposure from 200 yards in the lying unsupported position at a 4-foot classification target. Making this practice stand apart from other similar practices was the fact that here a respirator had to be worn. Interestingly, I happened to come by a period photograph, which would seem to represent the preamble to this very practice. Here, Canadian airborne troops draw ammunition for a range practice. An interesting mix of weapons is carried here, denoting sometime in the 1943 timeframe, perhaps. Of course, the salient point here is that the man on the left is holding a respirator. For this practice, I used a period-correct light pattern respirator of the type used from 1943. This is the style that figures prominently during the initial stages of the Normandy invasion.
Gas!
In this case, the canister was gutted so as to alleviate any possible contamination by old components therein, some of which contained asbestos. As a result, breathing in the respirator really wasn't affected, although because it was in a static position anyway, there wouldn't have been any issue. Two main observations were made here. One, the usual encumbrance afforded by the bulk of the respirator and the enhanced difficulty in attaining a good sight picture. And two, the fact that these early canister-style respirators, and their predecessors as well, did not have a nose cap inside. Without this feature, the air is not drawn across the lenses, and, resultingly, they tend to fog up more readily. The use of anti-fog material notwithstanding. As you can see here, I managed to finish the practice with a few seconds to spare.
Gas clear! Yeah. So that was 5 rounds with a gas mask on, lying in the open without any kind of rest at the 200-yard point. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So the group opened up quite considerably here. That said, it seemed to have just been centered enough to get 3 in the black and 2 misses, so that's a total of 18 points.
All in all, not too bad, and brought the score to 74, 6 points away from a second class, with 4 practices in hand. Practice 5 saw the range increase to 300 yards, with a 5-round application in the lying supported position at a 4-foot classification target. I did have some difficulty in finding a 300-yard range at this particular time, but I was able to use a distant woodline. As you may notice, there were some branches and small trees that were in the way. This may perhaps have distracted me in my initial efforts, and I forgot my rest. As you can see, I shot this practice unsupported. The snow, however, did make for a very nice and stable position, with nice deep elbow sockets to lock into.
So, that was practice 5, which was a 5-round application from the 300 in the prone supported position. Although, as you will have noticed from the footage, I somehow forgot to give myself the benefit of a sandbag or a rest, and I shot it prone unsupported, which, given the context and the results, I seem to have done all right anyway. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, just outside the figure here. So that gives a score of 19.
The group opened up to about 12 inches here, right on par with the standards of the day. And 19 points saw me pass the second class standard with a total of 93. Practice 6 was a 5-round snap of 5 5-second exposures from 300 yards in the lying supported position at a figure 4A. Much like practice 3, the aiming position was allowed for target engagement.
So here in the fading light, that's practice number 6, which was the 5-round snap from 300, 5 seconds per exposure. 1, 2, 3, 4, and I shanked one down here. So as per normal snap shooting scoring procedures, 3 points per hit, that gives a total of 12 points out of 15.
In looking at the target, I think I probably reverted to a 6 o'clock hold rather than a center of mass style. Had I not, a better score may have resulted. Practice 7 was a 10-round rapid in 1 40-second exposure from 300 yards standing in a trench at a 4-foot classification target. Here, conditions and location dictated that I not use the bench, as was the case with practices 2 and 3. I did, however, find a suitable stump with good clearance and elevation that filled the role of a trench parapet quite nicely. Please forgive my war-losing omission here. I obviously didn't close the pouch properly, and in the process of getting ready for the exposure, it opened up as I leaned into the stump. The practice went smoothly, if not especially rapidly. By definition, the rate was the same as the famous Practice 22 of 1914 fame, but here, with a somewhat more economical allotment of ammunition, albeit with a shorter time in which to shoot it.
So, Practice 7. 10-round rapid from 300 yards, standing in the trench. I might make a quick comparison here because the grouping seems to be quite good. As compared to the 1914 version Practice 22 that viewers of the channel might be familiar with. So, two things. One, an aperture sight on the number 4, and two, the use of a completely rested position versus lying in the open unsupported. Those two things seem to have combined to provide a much better result. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10 over here on the left. So all 10 rounds within the inner, which is a somewhat humbly a perfect score.
As per the rapid shooting scoring standard, the hits on the figure and the inner were both worth 3 points. The group was just a shade high, but they were all where they needed to be, and with that, managed to stampede across the first class line. Practice 8 was a 5-round application from 500 yards in the lying supported position at a 6-foot or large classification target. This one took a bit of doing, and I had to climb a large hill before I was able to shoot. The gap in the trees was just about perfect. And the scenery? Well, have a look.
Well, that's the target down there. But I think that I just might have stumbled across the most magnificent firing point ever. Let's hope I shoot as well, as the view is incredible.
After loading, I settled in. The position I found was such that I didn't need a rest. The ground was undulating enough to support the back of my hand nicely. There was a bit of a breeze up top of the hill, but down below, there really wasn't much of anything.
So with that practice, practice 8 at 500 yards here, that concludes the 1942 rifle course. Let's go down and check the target and see how we did. One thing that strikes me about today is not necessarily the target, although that's looking all right. What's really impressing me today is the fact that the conditions today are so much better than the last time I used this 6-foot target. We've had a bit of a perfect storm blow in. The wet target blew down and the tent blew over, and anyway, we'll score this later. Right, that was practice 8. 5-round application from 500 yards at a large or 6-foot classification target. Looking at the group, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Just cut the magpie up there. That was close. So, highest possible score of 20. Minus 1 here. Minus 2 there. So that gives a total of 17 points. And with that, the rifle course is done.
Overall, the grouping was a little bit high, but the score spoke for itself and I was more than happy with it. The 17 points rounded out the practices with a total score of 152 points. I must admit, I shot a little bit better than I was anticipating. The 110 points needed to become first class was more than just surpassed. As it pertains to badges and awards, Small Arms Training Volume 1, Pamphlet 1, Weapons Training of 1942, stipulates this. A reference contained therein indicated, according to the War Clothing Regulations of 1941, The standard of marksman didn't actually not exist, and therefore the badges associated with that status were not awarded.
So, another set of range practices is in the books. The 1942 rifle course was not perhaps comprehensive, as we've seen, but it certainly hit the high points. Engaging the man in grouping, application, snap, and rapid practices. It was by no means a throwaway set of practices. Indeed, they were shooting out to 500 yards. But when you compare it to the pre-war musketry program, it does come up somewhat short. That said, the economies needed in wartime were perhaps the harshest taskmaster. Well, I hope you enjoyed the presentation. I certainly had a great time shooting it. What it lacked in complexity, it certainly made up for in achievability. A fun shoot all around. Now, let's get out of this tin hat. Back into the old TOS. And where do we go from here? Well, maybe we'll go back. The 1939 range practices look like a good time.
If you'd like to support the channel, please stop by our Patreon page. The link is in the description below. And for more information on projects and updates between videos, follow us on our Facebook page.